Aloha! I'm Jane Kurahara, a volunteer docent at the Okage Sama Day exhibit at the Japanese Cultural Center of Hawaii. Welcome to our virtual tour of the World War II section of the exhibit. Please remember to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel to receive more content. Mahalo to the CPB Foundation and our other sponsors for their continued support. We will be exploring how World War II affected the Japanese population in Hawaii. There are three major parts to this segment. One, what was life like on the home front for those living in Hawaii during World War II? Two, what happened to a selective part of the Japanese population in Hawaii, namely those who were arrested and incarcerated? And three, what was the response of 10,000 Nisei sons, or second-generation American citizens of Japanese ancestry, to the war? December 7, 1941, and life in the Hawaiian Islands changed drastically. I was 10 years old then and woke up to an unusually noisy Sunday morning. My parents, equally puzzled, turned on the radio, and then puzzlement was replaced by fear. Japanese planes were bombing Pearl Harbor. War! Even as a child, I knew something fearful was happening. Civilian Governor Joseph B. Poindexter was in turmoil, but finally gave way to signing over to the military the governing of Hawaii. Like everyone else, he feared an invasion, and he knew that Hawaii needed military protection. Martial law with the military governor took over the governing of Hawaii on the afternoon of December 7th. As darkness fell, the military government issued orders to the Hawaii population. Curfew, everyone needs to be in their homes by 6 p.m. Blackout, from now on, there will be no lights to guide potential invaders. My memory of that first night is vivid to this day, over 75 years later. Our family sat in the dark, huddled around the radio, waiting for a possible invasion. In the days that followed, military orders that affected everyone came down. The one I remember most is that we all had to carry gas masks. Even the babies had bunny masks. While the December 7th attack was a surprise, a sense of possible war preceded that event. Back in 1940, Robert Shivers, head of the new local FBI office, asked Hung Wai Ching, first Asian YMCA director, to put together an interracial committee to help maintain harmony in Hawaii, despite the dangers of anti-Japanese racism, especially after December 7th. This committee worked with the vision expressed by Shigeo Yoshida, one of its members. In a memorable quote, he said, "How we in Hawaii are going to live together after the war will depend on how we live together during the war." The committee, eventually renamed the Morale Committee within the military government, worked hard toward this vision. In that spirit, I recall my father volunteering to be a volunteer fireman in our neighborhood. Others volunteered to be block wardens. My mother volunteered herself and all the aunties to sew materials for the Red Cross. At school, we were told to sell U.S. war bonds to our families, and school for me in the seventh grade meant school 4 days a week. On the fifth day, we all went to work in the pineapple fields. Labor was very short during the war, and that was one of the reasons the military government felt the mass evacuation of Japanese occurring on the West Coast would not work in Hawaii. Nearly 40% of Hawaii's population was of Japanese ancestry. Removing 157,000 people from the population would seriously damage the economy. Also, Japanese were generally not allowed to work in militarily strategic areas. For example, the few who were allowed to work at Pearl Harbor had to wear black badges. There were military orders for everyone, such as everyone had to be fingerprinted. But for Japanese aliens, or Issei, there were additional orders. They had to turn in any weapons, shortwave radios, binoculars, and cameras to the nearest police station. Fear also affected the Japanese population as some families burned, buried, or hid precious family heirlooms like samurai swords, kimonos, or family photos. One family built a wall and hid the photo of the emperor behind it. As a child, I was told not to speak Japanese anymore, so I couldn't talk to my grandmother. That was very sad. Let's now move on to a second section of how World War II affected the Japanese in Hawaii, the arrest and incarceration of a select group of Japanese. Little did most of Hawaii know that while we were all huddled in the blackout on the evening of December 7th, about 200 men of Japanese ancestry were arrested. These tended to be leaders in the Japanese community, religious, educational, and business leaders. Who were these people? And how come the military and FBI knew exactly where they lived? We found out much later that the FBI was working off custodial detention lists with the names, addresses, occupations all identified as early as the 1930s. For example, we found the name of Matsujiro Otani on an early 1937 list. Matsujiro Otani came to Hawaii as a young fisherman selling fish from a cart. On December 7th, he was celebrating the opening of his large fish market. By then, he was seen as a leader in the fishing industry. The FBI came to his home and arrested him, took him away, leaving behind a shocked wife and son. What will happen to him? Neither Matsujiro, his wife, nor his son knew what lay ahead. What was life like for these internees who were selectively arrested and eventually totaled about 1,300? Their lives were interrupted, their families ripped apart. While the heads of households were arrested, the families left behind struggled since the arrests. The families had bank accounts frozen, and some, like Dan Nishikawa's wife, was forced to close her sewing school. Also, the families were often stigmatized by the community, sometimes because of the fear of being interned too, sometimes because people were apprehensive that the one arrested must have done something wrong. Many years later in the 1980s, the truth and pain of this period became known. As former internees talked about this experience at wartime commission hearings, and as John Tateishi, head of the Redress Committee, noted, they spoke about incarceration on the mainland and Hawaii for the first time. Many sobbed as they recounted this period of life. Education through their painful testimony, plus research by Peter Irons, revealed that no Japanese was ever convicted of the crimes of espionage and sabotage during this period. With great effort, the Civil Liberties Act of 1988 was enacted, and redress and reparations were given to the internees who were still living. My late husband, who was incarcerated at Tule Lake Camp, told me that when he received his letter of apology from the President of the United States, a great weight came off his chest. To find out more about this dark period of history, we encourage you to view a 16-minute film about the untold story of the largest and longest used internment camp in Hawaii, the Honouliuli internment camp. The link is in the description below. Forward to 2015, and another important event occurred. President Barack Obama signed an executive order proclaiming Honouliuli a national monument to be preserved in perpetuity. The Dingell Bill was passed in Congress in 2018, and it made Honouliuli a national historic site. In his proclamation, President Obama said, "Honouliuli serves to remind every American about the critical importance of safeguarding civil liberties and maintaining our values during times of crisis. It is a place to reflect on wartime experiences and recommit ourselves to the pursuit of freedom and justice." The story of the Varsity Victory Volunteers begins our sharing of the third part of this World War II segment. When December 7th and the bombing was occurring, the University of Hawaii ROTC was mobilized to help defend Hawaii. Later, the group became part of the Hawaii Territorial Guard. Then, unfortunately, the government decided that the young men of Japanese ancestry that were in the group should be declared 4C ineligible alien and should no longer be part of this effort. The group felt this rejection deeply. Why? An earlier quote from Kinji Kanazawa, former student at Moilili Japanese Language School, may help us understand. He said, "We were taught in Japanese language school to love our country, but the country we were taught to love was the United States. So the burning question became, why is my loyalty being questioned?" In this moment of despair, Hung Wai Ching, director of the University of Hawaii YMCA, urged them to show their patriotism in other ways. "If you can't fight with guns, why not fight with shovels?" And they took up the challenge and became known as the Varsity Victory Volunteers, doing a great deal of labor work to help the war effort. The United States eventually decided to put together a segregated military unit of Japanese Americans, and many of the VVV voluntarily became a part of that unit. The United States asked for about 1,500 Nisei, or second-generation volunteers, from Hawaii to join this segregated unit. Instead, 10,000 volunteered. Included in the Hawaii volunteers were the sons of over 150 interned fathers. For example, Bolo Shirakata, son of Tamiichi Shirakata, was very concerned about his father's poor health. Interned at Honouliuli, the elder Shirakata spent much of his time in the camp hospital. Bolo volunteered for the 442nd in hopes that his father might somehow be released. The history of the 100th Battalion, 442nd Regimental Combat Team in World War II is a significant part of U.S. military history. This unit became the most highly decorated unit of its size in U.S. history. Their history is vividly recaptured in a 20-minute film about five Hawaii Nisei soldiers. We encourage you to find out more about their actions during the war by going to the link shared at the end of the narrative and viewing Ganbare, Never Give Up, Hawaii Soldiers in World War II. Finally, coming back to the question, why is my loyalty being questioned? We end this segment with a quote from a 442nd Regimental Combat Team veteran named Hirao Endo, who lost his eyesight when he was wounded in the war. When he was interviewed after the war, he said, "Although I lost my eyesight and unable to pursue my dreams, the sacrifices were well worth it because, for one thing, we were able to prove that we were loyal Americans of Japanese ancestry." Many other veterans, when interviewed, echoed a similar belief. And finally, why are the remaining veterans who returned to civilian life so dedicated to observing a special Veterans Memorial Day? It is to honor those who did not come back. We honor those now with a view of the wall of those missing and killed in action. Many families were affected by such losses. In our family, my cousin, James Kagihara, was killed shortly before the end of the war in Europe. At his funeral back in Hawaii, his family was given a flag with a gold star. Flags were flown in the window by families during the war. If the flag had a blue star, it meant that their son was fighting in the war. If the flag had a gold star, it meant that they had a son who was killed fighting in the war. A long and difficult time was over. Yasutaro Soga, interned at age 68 and editor of the Japanese language newspaper Nippujiji, summed up war in a moving tanka poem. "There is nothing more sorrowful than war. Here alone, all of life's sadness is brought together." With the post-war period looming, what will happen next? Thanks for watching. Please remember to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel to receive more content. Mahalo to the CPB Foundation and our other sponsors for their continued support.